Thank you. So, is it okay for the sound? Yeah, okay. So, good morning. This morning I'm going to give some information about the transcendence proofs without being too technical. Before starting this lecture, I would like first to make an announcement, which is that the transparencies which I show here are now on my website. And so the four first transparencies. This lecture, the text is not written. I am sorry, I did not succeed to complete it. But the transparencies which you will see are on my website. I put them yesterday evening. And also the one of yesterday, which I did not show completely. I have another announcement. I made a mistake yesterday, which was pointed out to me by mentioning the genus of the Fermat curve. So the result is that the genus is n minus 1, n minus 2 over 2. So for n equal 1 and 2, the genus is 0. For n equal 3, it's an elliptic curve with complex multiplication by the cube root of unity. And for n equal 4, the genus is 3. But the Abelian variety, the Jacobian, is a product of three elliptic curves with complex multiplication by the fourth root of unity. And this is because of the elliptic curves that we get the Chaula-Selberg formula and the values gamma of 1/4. And finally, for n equal 5, the genus is 6, but it's a product of three simple Abelian surfaces, so the Abelian varieties of dimension 2 for the Jacobian. And the endomorphisms are given by the fifth root of unity. And this is how gamma of 1/5 comes into the picture. So this is just an erratum. So I will review some different proofs in the transcendental number theory, and I will start with Liouville proof. When Liouville showed the existence of transcendental numbers, in fact, he proved a property which is true for all real algebraic numbers, which is that these numbers cannot be approximated too well by rational numbers. And therefore, if a real number does not satisfy the conclusion, so if for each kappa there is a rational number with this inequality, then this number xi should be a transcendental number. So this is, to a certain extent, the first proof of transcendence and the transcendence of such numbers. And the proof goes like this. You start with an algebraic number, so there is a polynomial such that f of alpha is equal to 0. You define by d the degree, and you take a rational number which is not alpha, and therefore f of p over q will be non-zero, at least if you have taken f irreducible. Now, this number is a non-zero rational integer, therefore it is at least 1, and this gives a low bound for f of p over q. On the other hand, it's not difficult to give an upper bound for this value in terms of alpha. If f of p over q is small, it means that p over q is close to root of f. And therefore, you get this low bound, which is there. So this is really the first proof. And I will say that the auxiliary function is just the minimal polynomial of the algebraic number alpha. I mentioned in the previous lectures and mainly in the first lecture the irrationality proofs, and the first results were proved using continued fractions. And this was the way that the irrationality of pi was proved by Lambert in 1767. To see the analogy between the work of Lambert and the one of Hermite, the best solution is just to listen to what Hermite said in a letter in 1749. He said, tout ce que je puis, c'est de refaire ce qu'a déjà fait Lambert, seulement d'une autre manière. So my translation will be, all I can do is to repeat what Lambert did, just in another way. And so it's interesting to see how Hermite relates his own work to the work of Lambert, which did not involve at all the formula, analytic formulae from Hermite, at least explicitly. You will get more information on that on the two papers by Brzezinski. One is published in the lecture notes. It's a rather long paper. And the other is a book on the history of continued fractions.
So and is the date something wrong with Lambert? It seems later on than Hermite.
For which one? Lambert?
That 17, seems later 16. Than Hermite.
Oh, yes. Oh, excuse me. Yeah. Hermite was later. Yeah. I am sorry. So the proof of Fourier for the irrationality of E that we saw in the first lecture was just to truncate the Taylor expansion at the origin. And so in this case, I will say that the auxiliary function is a polynomial. Or, in fact, it's not exactly the polynomial. It is a difference between E of Z and the tail, the head of the Taylor expansion. So the auxiliary function will be the remainder, the tail of the expansion. There were other examples, as we saw by Liouville, using continued fraction and fast converging series. And the main step, as I mentioned in the second lecture, was done by Hermite, so I suppose these dates are correct now, and he gave some approximation of the exponential function by rational function, which means that the Taylor developments match for the first terms. And so I will say that the auxiliary function is B of Z exponential of Z minus A of Z. A and B are polynomials, and the condition on A and B are that this function has a zero of high multiplicity at the origin. So this is really the first main auxiliary function, which looks like most of the one we are going to see now. I mentioned in my second lecture that irrationality results follow from rational approximation to the exponential function. And what Hermite did in order to get transcendence is to consider simultaneous rational approximation to the exponential function. And so what he did, and I explained it, is that he constructed polynomials in Z of X such that B0 of X exponential of X minus BK of X, which is a remainder, will have a high multiplicity of zero at the origin. And if you remember, the proof of the transcendence of E follows by specializing X equal one. We get a simultaneous approximation to the exponential of 1 up to exponential of m, and the remainder, the value of the remainder, which is this linear combination at 1, is positive and less than 1. So this was the sketch of the proof of Hermite. More precisely, Hermite solved the following problem, which we are going to call Padé problem of type 2. If we give pairwise complex numbers, pairwise distinct complex numbers, and rational integers, then he constructs explicitly polynomials B0, B1, Bn, such that B0 of z exponential of alpha k minus bk of z has a zero at the origin of multiplicity at least n. So this is the first example of what Padé did, which in he said this, which was to construct approximation of complex analytic functions by rational functions. And I told you that these are the Padé approximants of type 2. So the general definition is for complex functions which are analytic near the origin. In the case of Hermite, these were the functions 1 and the exponential of alpha z, alpha kz. And the type 2 corresponds to the following problem. We are looking for polynomials B0, Bn, with some bounds for the degree of the Bi, such that each of the functions which is here has a zero of multiplicity at least n. To take all the I and j between 0 and n, in fact, it's sufficient to take I equals 0 and to take all the j, just a simple trick. So you get references on this, for instance, in the book by Feldman and Nesterenko, in 1998. So this is the type 2. The type 1 is, to a certain extent, the dual of the type 2, and it is the following. Again, we have functions, but I number them f1 up to fm, which are complex, analytic near the origin, and we have non-negative integers. And the question is to find polynomials P1, Pn of degree bounded such that the linear combination which is here has a zero at the origin of multiplicity sufficiently large. So in the previous case, we were considering simultaneous approximation. And here, we are interested in linear forms, linear combinations of the Fi. In fact, Hermite himself studied this problem and solved this problem in the case of the exponential function. He did it already in 1873. He did it again in 1893. And in fact, he got in 1993 the complete solution to this problem. He gave explicitly the polynomials which are associated to that. Further, in 1917, he gave integral formulae for the remainder. It's remarkable that this construction was not used by Hermite himself. It was used only by Mahler in 1930. And Mahler used this construction, which is here, to get effective versions of the Lindemann and Weierstrass theorem. Okay, so the next step will be to investigate more thoroughly the algebraic values of transcendental functions. The basic example being exponential of z, and we would like to know whether it's possible to extend the results to other functions. One main condition on the exponential function is that it is a transcendental function, which means that the two functions z and f of z are algebraically independent. If you take a polynomial which is non-zero, then the function p of z and f of z is not the zero function. So it's an exercise to see that an entire function, which it's entire, which means analytic in C, is transcendental if and only if it is not a polynomial. So you could ask why is it useful to introduce a word just to say that a function is not a polynomial? It is because there are some algebraic functions which are analytic in a small neighborhood, in a neighborhood of one. But for the entire ones, these are only the polynomials. So the kind of problem we are going to study is the situation of Hermite Lindemann, which states that the function exponential of z, which is transcendental and entire, takes algebraic value at an algebraic argument only for z equals zero. So Weierstrass asked the following general question. Is it true that the transcendental entire function takes usually transcendental values at algebraic arguments? And in fact, he found himself the answer in 1886, and he wrote it to Strauss. And he found that it's possible to construct some specific series, F, which take many algebraic values. And this subject was developed by many mathematicians. And it is known, for example, that if you take a countable subset of C and a dense subset of C, it's possible to construct a transcendental entire function which maps S into C. So algebraic numbers disappear here. We just use the fact that algebraic numbers are both countable and dense. So it's possible to map the algebraic integers into algebraic numbers into themselves, and Fritz Böckers gave you a construction of that. We can also add the derivatives. It's not difficult. And so the example which Fritz explained is an example of a transcendental entire function which maps with all the derivatives any algebraic number into the field Q of alpha. So when we see such a statement saying that there is no general result, we do not stop. We continue to study the question, but we see that we need some assumptions. Which assumption should we add? The most natural one is to put some restrictions on the functions. We will not consider all the functions, but only some functions. It's interesting that the theory developed from another point of view, which is not to restrict the set of functions, but the set of values, both the argument and the values. And the first example is very modest from a certain point of view. Instead of looking at algebraic values of the functions at algebraic points, what we will consider is the integer values at integer points. So to replace all the algebraic numbers by the integers is very restrictive, but at least it will produce some results. This is what is called an integer-valued entire function. It's a function f, which is entire, analytic in C, and maps the positive, non-negative integers into Z. So an example is 2 raised to the power Z. It is an integer-valued entire function, and it is not a polynomial. So the question is, are there integer-valued entire functions growing slower than 2 to the Z without being a polynomial? It is remarkable that this question will have some connection with transcendental numbers because it does not seem to be so transcendental. I remind you the definition that for an entire function f, we denote by fr the maximum of f on the disk of radius r. So Polya was the first to study this question, and he found that 2 to the z indeed is the smallest entire function, which is not a polynomial, and which has the property that f of n is in z for all n in z. And the smallest is for the growth order. Another function will have the limit sup of 2 to the r, fr is at least 1. So it should grow faster than the, at least like 2 to the z. There has been a lot of work on this topic by many mathematicians. There are a lot of variants which have been introduced. We can ask that the derivative also take some values. We can ask, for example, that some derivatives, 2 derivatives at each point, or finitely many derivatives, or we can ask all the derivatives. There is some interesting work also where you ask the nth derivative at n. So the nth derivative of f at the point n should be an integer. So this kind of subject can be studied and has been studied. Also, we can replace the positive integers by all the integers. F of z is included in z. So a lot of work has been done on this topic. Just a few words about the proof by Polya. He starts by expanding the function f in a Newton interpolation series at the point 0, 1, 2, which means that he writes an expansion with 1, z, zz minus 1, zz minus 1, z minus 2, and so on. The fact that f of n is an integer shows that the coefficients Rn are rational numbers by induction. And it's not too difficult to get an upper bound for the denominators. Now, if f does not grow fast, we can deduce that the coefficients are rather small, and I will explain you how we do that. And since there are rational numbers with a bounded denominator, they should vanish for sufficiently large n, and therefore f will be a polynomial. So this is the sketch of the proof. Now I would like to say a little bit more on how to bound the coefficients a n. And for that, you repeat how to construct the coefficients. The first coefficient is just f of alpha 1, and then we have z minus alpha 1 times f1. Now, f1, you write it f1 of alpha 2 plus z minus alpha 2 f2. And therefore, you will get the expansion by taking a0 equal f of alpha 1, a1 is f1 of alpha 2, and an is fn of alpha n plus 1. So this is the way you get the coefficients in this Newton interpolation series. Now, to get some formula for these coefficients, we can use an identity which is due to Hermite. You start from this very simple identity. 1 over x minus z is 1 over x minus alpha times some fraction times 1 over x minus z. And you see that this and that are the same. So it is like we did for the continued fraction expansion with square root of 2. We can just replace 1 over x minus z by this expression. And we can replace alpha by alpha 1. And the next one, we replace it by x alpha 2. So we get this expression for 1 over x minus z. This is the first term. This is this quotient. And this number is just obtained by the same formula. When you repeat like this, you find this identity, which has the property that 1 over x minus z is a sum, finite sum. Here you have a polynomial in z of degree j, and then you have a remainder, which has here a polynomial of degree n. Once you have this identity, you multiply by 1 over 2 pi I, f of z, where f is an analytic function, and you integrate on a certain disk, a circle. And so when you integrate, you find a finite sum with z minus alpha 1, z minus alpha j, plus a remainder. The first sum that you have involves some aj, which are just the coefficient you are looking for. And these are integrals of f of x divided by that. And this should be a small f, sorry. And the remainder has the same expression. And like this, it's not so difficult to get upper bound for aj if you know that f has a small growth. The formula of Hermit was developed by a mathematician whose name is famous, but this mathematician is not so well known. He's René Lagrange, and this is not a mistake for the date. It's 1935. And René Lagrange gave a similar formula. You have 1 over x minus z, you have 1 over x minus z, but the first term which is here involves degree 2 in the denominator. What is more interesting here is this, which is a rational function. So here, instead of having a numerator, which is a polynomial, you have a rational function. And again, this identity is easy to check. Once you have it, you can iterate. You can multiply by 1 over 2 pi I f of z. And you look at what you get. And you get a development of an analytic function as a series, but the series now is a series in rational functions instead of polynomials. So this formula was forgotten more or less until recently when Rivoal used it with the Hurwitz zeta function, and he expanded this Hurwitz zeta function into series, and the expansion that he got gave some coefficients which are related with zeta of 3. And like this, he produced a new proof of Appert's theorem on the irrationality of zeta of 3. And in the same way, by expanding sum of minus 1 to the k over k plus z, so it's the divergent case, but we take an alternating series, we get an irrationality of log 2. It's very frustrating that this proof, which does not look at all like Appert's proof, produces exactly the same approximants as in the Appert's proof and other proofs. Once you see the two formulae by Hermite and Lagrange, it's possible to mix them, to use sometimes one, sometimes the other. And this is what Rivoal did, and he got a new proof of the irrationality of zeta of 2. And so the Hermite-Lagrange series that he takes is a fraction, but you have a numerator which is the of degree, which is twice the degree of the denominator. So, if you look at the Taylor series, there are special cases of Hermite's formula when you take all the points which are the same, but you repeat them, and so you have multiplicities. And the Hermite's formula gave rise to Padé approximant. And again, it's possible to develop a theory which is a little bit similar, but with rational interpolation and using Lagrange interpolation formula. So I come back now to Polyas' work. Polyas studied the integer-valued entire functions which map the positive integers into Z or the integers into Z. And it seems a mild extension to replace Z by Z of I. And it was done by Gelfond in 1929. What Gelfond did is to study the growth of entire functions which map the Gaussian integers into themselves, and the idea is just to replace z by z of I, and he develops the function in interpolation series at the points of z of I. And the result is that an entire function which is not a polynomial and map the Gaussian integers into themselves has a growth order at least like the exponential of z squared. So it grows much faster than the exponential. The value that Gelfond produced for gamma was not so sharp, but it was explicit. It was improved until Gramin found the best possible result in 1981, which is pi over 2e. And the fact that it is best possible arises from a previous work by David Masser in 1980. Just in the same time as he studied the integer-valued entire function on z of I, Gelfond found the transcendence of e to the pi. And the connection between both is the following. Assume that e to the pi is a rational number to start with. Then, when you look at the function exponential of pi z, this function takes values which are rational Gaussian numbers when the argument is a Gaussian integer. And so it does not map the integers into the integers. There are some denominators, but we know the denominators, and the proof works well. And in fact, it works not only for irrationality, but even for transcendence. And this was really the first step towards a solution of Hilbert Seven's problem. And the proof is just to expand exponential of pi z into an interpolation series at the Gaussian integers. So this was the proof of Gelfond in 1929. After that, Gelfond and Schneider found a complete solution of Hilbert Seven's problem on the transcendence of alpha to the beta. And I would like to say a few words on their proof. There is a duality between the methods of Gelfond and Schneider, and this duality can be explained by means of Fourier-Borel transform. I will not go into that, but there are some explanation on what is going on. So I want to prove that it's not possible for alpha, beta, and alpha to the beta to be all three algebraic. I will argue by contradiction. I assume that they are algebraic. Beta is irrational. Log alpha is not zero. And alpha to the beta is exponential log alpha. So we consider the number field Q of alpha, beta, and alpha to the beta. The idea of Gelfond is to start with the two entire functions, exponential of z and exponential of beta z, which are algebraically independent. The polynomial in these two functions will not vanish because beta is irrational. They satisfy differential equation with, with algebraic coefficients. And they take simultaneously values in k for infinitely many z, which are all the multiples of log alpha. And this is an infinite set because log alpha is not zero. So this is the starting point of Gelfond. The starting point of Schneider is to use the two entire functions z and alpha to the z, which is exponential z log alpha. Again, these functions are algebraically independent because this one is entire and is not a polynomial. And this function satisfies take simultaneously values in k for infinitely many z, and in fact here we have a z module of rank 2, all the linear combination between 1 and beta, and this is of rank 2 because beta is irrational. The fact that the function are algebraically independent is because log alpha is not zero. There is a big difference that here we had differential equations, and here the differential equations do not have algebraic coefficients. They have transcendental coefficients. But to a certain extent, we have something better here. The function grows more slowly, and we have more points because we have a z-module of rank 2. I find it interesting that the proof of Schneider used z and alpha to the z, because this looks more like the proof of Gelfond on the transcendence of e to the pi, which was to use exponential of pi z. But it turns out that this is how Schneider worked and how Gelfond found the solution. So once we have this data, you see that there is some similarity between both data. We have functions, we have sometimes multiplicities, and we have values at many points. What do we do? For Gelfond, we consider polynomials in exponential of z and exponential of beta z. This means that we take monomials, which are exponential of s1 plus s2 beta. Now we take derivatives because this function satisfies differential equation, and we substitute a multiple of log alpha, and then we get an algebraic number in K. So this is Gelfond. What does Schneider do? He considers the two functions z and alpha to the z, so we can take monomials in z and alpha to the z, and we evaluate this function at the points s1 plus s2 beta. And again, we will get an algebraic number in the field K. But if you look, I selected the notation in such a way that we get exactly the same number. Both numbers are the same, and the number is just displayed here. So this is the analogy between the two methods. But there is another strong analogy, which is that they need to construct an auxiliary function. Well, this is the subject of my talk today. And the auxiliary function that they construct arises from Ziegel's lemma and Dirichlet's box principle. Dirichlet introduced the box principle to study Diophantine questions, and Toué and Ziegel used this idea of Dirichlet to produce auxiliary functions, which were very efficient for transcendence purposes. So this comes from the work of Toué first on Diophantine approximation. Toué was the first to improve Liouville's inequality and get a low bound for alpha minus p over q, which is stronger than Liouville. To improve Liouville's theorem, the idea of Toué was, instead of evaluating the minimal polynomial of alpha at a rational number, to consider not only one approximation, but two approximations, p1 over q1 and p2 over q2. And then he will evaluate at the point p1 over q1, p2 over q2, a polynomial in two variables. So, Toué studied several examples of constructions of such polynomials. He used hypergeometric series. He used explicit construction. And then he discovered that it's possible to work without knowing explicitly the function. So we often say we will construct an auxiliary function. In fact, we do not construct it. We show that it exists. So we use Dirichlet's box principle and show that there is a function which satisfies some conditions. Which conditions are asked? What we ask is that the function which arises from P, the function P, which is a polynomial here, has a zero of multiplicity sufficiently large at 0, 0 and P1 over Q1, P2 over Q2. Here, when Toué considers the order of zero, it is not the classical order because he puts some weight on the two variables, which is not the same. So this gives rise to the index of a polynomial at a point. If you remember the different proofs which we saw, very often we need to check that some number is non-zero, and this was certainly one of the main difficulties that Toué had to overcome, which was to find a non-zero value of some derivative. The method of Toué needs some two approximation, and what he does is to take a very good approximation P1 over Q1, but the second approximation P2 over Q2 depends on the first one. So he argues by contradiction. He assumes that there is infinitely many counterexamples. He takes a first counterexample, and then he takes the second one sufficiently large with respect to the first. So a very sharp approximation P1 over Q1 is required. And most often, we do not know that there exists one. We argue by contradiction. Nevertheless, it's possible to develop the method and see that it's possible to get a result which is more or less effective, apart from one exception. We say that if there is some exception, then we can complete the proof in an effective way. And Cassels and Davenport obtain upper bound for the number of solutions of Diophantine equations. They are not able to solve the Diophantine equation, but they are able to say there is at most one exception, or at most a certain number of exceptions. Bombieri succeeded to produce examples where sufficiently sharp approximation exists, and then he produced effective refinement to Liouville's inequality by extending the argument. So he succeeded to produce sufficiently sharp approximation in such a way that the method becomes effective. Okay, let us go back to the early 20th century. Siegel improved to his result and also gave application of the idea of constructing auxiliary function to transcendence questions, periods of elliptic function, which I discussed yesterday. To continue with Diophantine approximation, the work of Toué Siegel was developed by many mathematicians, including Dyson, Gelfond, Schneider, until Roth in 1955 obtained the best possible exponent in Liouville's inequality, which is 2 plus epsilon in place of the degree. And this is not the end of the story, because Wolfgang Schmidt proved higher dimensional generalization of the 2 Siegel-Roth theorem, which I mentioned in my second lecture, I think, or third lecture. And one of the main difficulties is, again, the zero estimate, which is more and more difficult with the progress of the theory. Okay, so this Dirichlet box principle will be used to construct auxiliary function. The idea is the following. Assume that you have a transcendental entire function which takes algebraic values at a sequence of algebraic points, maybe including derivative, and in this case we repeat the points. The example is the exponential function with the point alpha, 2 alpha, 3 alpha, but we may repeat the points, and instead, if we repeat alpha 2 times, we consider that the second time we take the derivative of f. We want to get the contradiction and a suitable assumption, and the basic point is the following. F is a transcendental entire function. This means exactly that if we take a polynomial which is non-zero, then f of z and p of z is not the zero function. So the contradiction will come from that. We are going to construct or to show the existence of a polynomial which is non-zero so that this function is zero. And we will proceed in several steps. The first step will be to show the existence of such a polynomial p, for which the function p of z and f of z vanishes. The goal is to obtain all the zk, but we are not able to obtain immediately all the zk. We just ask that it vanishes at z1, zn. If some zi are repeated, it means that we take derivatives. So this is easier because we have finitely many conditions to satisfy. And this is where the Dirichlet box principle will be used. We construct a polynomial with finitely many conditions. And then, by an extrapolation argument, by induction, we show that f will vanish also at the next points, and finally will vanish at all the zk. So Siegel was the first to explain how to do that, and he explained how to construct a suitable auxiliary function for transcendence purposes. In 1929, as you know from the lectures by Fritz Böckers, he introduced the notion of E and G functions. And in the case of G functions, he just considered 2 points, 0 and alpha with multiplicity, which means that it looks really very much like the proof of Hermite. But in some other cases, like E functions, it takes more points. So this is similar with the Hermite-Padé approximation of the first type, but the auxiliary functions now are no more explicit. And also, Siegel does not require to have the best estimate for the order of zero. In the converse, he prefers to have a weaker estimate and to have some control on the coefficients. Another method which has been developed by Mahler and which I did not discuss too much so far is due to Mahler, and it works with functions satisfying a functional equation. And it's interesting that the auxiliary function is constructed by means of linear algebra and not by means of Dirichlet box principle. But again, it's not an explicit auxiliary function. In 1949, Schneider produced the first criterion, which is a general criterion on the values of analytic function. It is an interesting paper, but the result is extremely technical. the assumptions in the theorem are very complicated. He was able to deduce from his general statement the theorem of Hermite-Lindemann, Gelfand-Schneider, and the six exponential. Later in 1957, he gave variants of this criterion in his book, and the variants are still complicated, but they are much easier than the original result. In 1964, Serge Lang gave several simpler statements in some papers and in his book on transcendental numbers. And there are mainly two statements through two criteria. One is for functions satisfying differential equations, and this is the criterion which is called the Schneider-Lang criterion. It contains the theorem of Fermi-Lindemann and the solution of Hilbert's seventh problem, but only by Gelfand's method, not by Schneider's method, because he requires differential equations with algebraic coefficients. The other criterion of Serge-Lang works essentially with functions satisfying a functional equation, like the exponential function and the addition theorem. And it contains the solution of Hilbert's seventh problem by Schneider's method and the six exponential theorem, but it does not contain the theorem of Fermi-Lindemann. But the statement is not as complicated as the original statement of Schneider. Nevertheless, the second criterion is more complicated than the Schneider-Lang criterion, and so I will just restrict it to the criterion with multiplicities that you saw yesterday in the lecture by Paula Cohen. I use the definition that an entire function has a finite order of growth if the maximum of f grows no more than r to the rho. By the way, Paula gave the definition here of a meromorphic function which is of growth order less than rho. And this definition, you find it, for example, in Lang's book. And the definition is the following. A meromorphic function is said to be of order at most rho if it is the quotient of two entire functions of order at most rho. And I don't remember whether you realize that when you give a definition, you have to be careful. And you are not allowed to give this definition unless you prove some preliminary lemma. And the preliminary lemma is that if you take a function which is entire, if you are able to write it as a quotient of two entire functions of order at most rho, then as an entire function, the given function has an order at most rho. And this is harmless in this case because the lemma is true. But Lang did the same with the height of polynomials. He defined the height of polynomials as the maximum of the absolute values of the coefficients. And then he defined the height of rational fractions. And he said the rational fraction is a quotient, of height at most h. If it is the quotient of two polynomials of height at most h. But it does not work because the lemma in this case is not true. So it's important to be careful when you give a definition. I decided to restrict myself to analytic functions. The criterion is valid for meromorphic functions. And it's very important for elliptic functions, which I studied yesterday. But I prefer to be as simple as possible, and I take just two entire functions. We assume that they have finite order of growth. We have a number field, and we assume that we have differential equations. The differential equations are the following. The derivative of f1 and f2 are polynomials in f1 and f2. And then the conclusion that the set of W in C, so that the two functions take value in K, is a finite set. There are some more general differential equations which are allowed. Paula gave a more general statement here yesterday, but this will be sufficient for what I do now. So the assumption is the differential equation f'1 is a polynomial in f1, f2. f'2 is a polynomial in f1, f2. And the conclusion is that if you look at the set of W where the two values are in K, this set is finite. So this is just what you have to remember. The two main examples of this criterion in this special case are the Hermite-Lindemann theorem on the transcendence of exponential of beta. You take z and exponential of z. You have differential equation with algebraic coefficients. And the two functions take values in the number field q of beta and exponential of beta at infinitely many points. So this is sufficient to deduce a contradiction if you assume that this is a number field. and beta is not zero. Another corollary is Gelfand-Schneider's theorem by the method of Gelfand, which means that you take exponential of z and exponential of beta z. Again, you have differential equations, and you have two functions which take values in a number field at infinitely many points, because log alpha is not zero. There are some refinements. For example, there is an upper bound for the number of exceptional values w. If rho I is the order of fi, it's possible to prove such an upper bound. And there have been some improvements. Shumnovsky succeeded to get in some special cases some upper bound which does not depend on the degree of the number field. It's possible to extend to meromorphic functions and to have more general differential equations which allow the differential equation of the elliptic function. And also there are some extensions in several variables which are due to Schneider first in 1948, when he got his result on the transcendence of beta and of A and B. He did not state explicitly the criterion, but it was done by Lang and then by Bombieri, who solved the conjecture of Nagata. I will not go too far on this topic, but essentially, in the case of one dimension, one variable, the conclusion is that some set is finite. In the case of in a higher dimensional case, Schneider considered Cartesian product, and Nagata suggested that the condition that the set is finite could be replaced by the condition that the set is contained in an algebraic hypersurface. And this was solved by Bombieri. So he replaces the number of elements by the smallest degree of an algebraic hypersurface containing the set. The main difficulty in the proof in the higher dimension case is to produce a Schwarz-Lehmann in several variables. So Schneider did it for Cartesian product. Bombieri-Lang used the Lelong theory of functions of several variables, and Bombieri used L2 estimates of Hermander. Okay, I repeat briefly the proof which was sketched by Paula Cohen yesterday, the proof of the criterion. We argue by contradiction. We have two functions which take simultaneously algebraic values in K for W in C, and we want to show that there is a non-zero polynomial so that the function is a zero function. This is what I explained before. So the first step is to solve a system of finitely many equations using Dirichlet-Box principle. We show that there exists a non-zero polynomial so that the function P of F1, F2 has a zero of high multiplicity at each W. So W is a finite set, sufficiently large but finite. So we have finitely many conditions. And we ask a zero of multiplicity T. So it's a finite set of conditions to satisfy. We have a set of homogeneous linear equations with coefficients in K. And if the number of equations is less than the number of unknown, we know that there is a non-trivial solution. But we need a little bit more. And this is where Two-Siegel lemma comes into the picture. We want an estimate for the coefficients of the polynomial P, which will give rise to F. And the coefficients are algebraic integers in K. So we need to bound the height or the size, if you prefer, of the coefficients. For this, it's better to have sufficiently many unknowns. For example, this is what Paula did yesterday, to have twice many unknowns than equation, and then you get some sharp estimates. Now we want to prove that F is the zero function. We know that it has zero of high multiplicity at W. By induction, we are going to prove that it has a zero of multiplicity one more. We go from T to T prime, and we will proceed by induction on T prime. At the end, we will deduce that the function F is zero because it has zero of infinitely multiplicity, and this will be the contradiction that we were looking for. So the induction is that F has a zero of multiplicity at least T prime, and then we want to have T prime plus one. Because we have many zeros, we show that the function F is small in some disk. And this is Schwarz's lemma, which I alluded to before, and which I will state just after. Once you we know that f has a small modulus in a disk, we deduce that its derivative also has small modulus. This is just a Cauchy's inequality. On the other hand, the t prime derivative of f is an algebraic integer in k, and it has a small absolute value from what we said before. And we just use Liouville's inequality, not the classical one which I mentioned before, but the variant of Liouville inequality. It can be the product formula or the size inequality. There are several variants. But the result is that an algebraic number cannot be too small without being zero. Okay, so I just complete with the Schwarz lemma. Thank you. And the Schwarz lemma is just an upper bound for a function of a single variable. And the proof of the Schwarz lemma is here. So I will not show you all the transparencies which are remaining, but you will see them on my website. Thank you.
You mentioned some growth estimates about the integer valued functions that are entire non-polynomial.
Yes.
Do we have similar estimates for when we consider the ring of integers of a certain number field?
Yes. When if you replace z by the ring of integers on a number field, the problem will be that if you take a discrete ring of integers, then it works. And this is what Gelfond did with z of I. If you take an imaginary quadratic number field, then the ring of integers is discrete, and then it will work. If it is not discrete, then you get into a trouble. You cannot assume that the image is discrete. So then it's more difficult. But they have some work has been done on this matter. Yeah.
Any other questions? All right, thank you again.